Let's see if we got any action here. Okay, we're rolling. And I mean, does this light bother you? Does that bother you?
No. No, I've been under those lights so many times, so much of my life with Frank.
Oh, yes. Well, we were speaking, you brought up Frank Adams. Can you tell us something about Frank Adams?
I met the Adams when I was 10 years old and lived in Whitehall. I was born in Whitehall.
I see.
And,
What was your maiden name?
Margrave.
Margrave, okay.
Yeah. And, theater was just built, the Newfer Adams Theater, which is now how Met.
Okay. Now, your husband built that? I mean, Frank built that?
Well, there was a dramatic club in Whitehall. Of course, he was a playwright, too, you know. He'd written 13 music and were produced musical comedies in his life.
Mm-hmm. Could you name some of them?
Oh, Lordy. No.
Okay.
I've got, you know, scripts. Well, the scripts of all his stuff, and his books, and his magazine stories. 1,500 pounds of published material after a summer of my working, gathering up stuff, left, and I sort of felt the house must have risen. 3/4 of a ton of published words.
My goodness.
Well, he had, he started out, his first musical comedy, well, he wrote the song I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now, you know.
That's right.
And there were, of course, songs in all the musical comedy.
Now, were these Broadway musicals?
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
And he lived in Chicago. And he used to come up with his co-writer, Will Huff, Bill Huff, H-O-U-G-H, summers to Whitehall, the resort at the foot of Main Street.
Okay.
But, and then another summer he came up and had a cottage down where the, do you know where Willie and Oriel Squires lived?
The name sounds familiar, but I'm not sure.
Well, it's a resort down the, not a resort, it's a row of cottages.
Okay.
And he stayed there. And would be writing the next production.
Now, about how old was he at this point in time?
He's still in college.
He was still, what college did he attend?
University of Chicago.
Okay, thank you.
And you ask me questions and I'll...
Well, you keep going, you're doing.
And I'll answer. And his parents also came up to White Lake in the summertime, which has introduced him to White Lake. And they used to go someplace every winter, some different place, to after their productions were all set and everything, to start writing the next one. And he was in Coronado. They were, he and Bill Huff. And that's off San Diego. Do you know Coronado at all?
No, I don't.
And his first wife, Trix. They were married in 1907. He was born in 1883. Yeah, 1883, yeah. And seems a lot older than I. And I first met him when I was taking a little girl to the movie in Whitehall, which was an afternoon matinee. they used to do the early kid things, and it cost a nickel to get into the theater, and I had my nickel, and the little girl I had was had with me had her 5 pennies and lost one on the way, and Frank Adams was happened to be at the theater, standing on the outside talking to somebody. And I couldn't miss. Well, they were serials that the Pearl. You wouldn't know about that so far back.
Tom Mix and.
No, back of Tom Mix.
Back of Tom Mix, back in the.
Oh, yeah.
Like, what would be the serial? What do you remember any?
I don't remember the titles or anything, but oh, we all had to see those serials. Anyway.
They were silent then, of course. And,
yeah. And a piano down and playing the music.
Do you remember who played the piano at that playhouse?
Seems to me Burtis Norman did it one time. No, I don't.
That's okay.
And, must have been someone I knew.
So you met Frank that day, the girl
I shyly went up and asked him, told him about this little girl with me, only had 4 pennies. And she'd lost one on the way. And if I would come back later in the day or tomorrow with her penny, would he let her in now? I was afraid I was going to miss it. Perils of Pauline were way... That was...
That was some...
Yeah.
Tying to the railroad tracks and...
oh, yeah. All that sort of thing.
Who played the lead? Do you remember anybody?
Well, I don't know. Pearl White was one that was an actress that did that sort of thing.
Uh-huh.
But anyhow, he was highly amused, and he allowed his yes. He'd let the little girl in, and I wouldn't have to come back with the penny. And I thought he was the nicest man I'd ever met. Happened my father read to us all the time, and Frank Adams had a serial running in one of the magazines. I think it was either Red Book or Green Book. There was several of those magazines. Mm-hmm. He always had a story in Cosmopolitan magazine.
What were the stories about? What did he generally write?
All fiction, and in the magazine stories, all love stories, really. Uh-huh. Later he did several westerns. But as I say, he married his first wife and bought the Vandeventer house. In fact, he sold it to the Vandeventers. He bought it. I can't remember the name of the people from whom he bought it, the people who had it built. But it was the biggest house on Sylvan Beach, you know, the one above the tennis court. Well,
right.
You know Peg's house. It's a lovely house. And then I was chosen. The seniors were having, and I think Marie Staples was a senior. Now, you must know Marie Staples in Whitehall.
Yeah, I know the name.
Yeah. And the seniors were going to do their annual play, which the seniors always did.
Can you tell me what year this was approximately?
Maybe 12, maybe 1912 or 13.
Around 12 or 13. Okay,
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, see, I was born in '03, the end of '03.
The end of '03.
Yeah, I might just as, because it's December 30, I'll be 90.
Okay.
I was born in '03. And they needed a youngster, and I was little. And I must have been maybe in your mother's classroom or in the eighth grade.
Oh, my grandmother, Edith.
I mean your grandmother.
Mm-hmm. Her name was Edith Quackenbush?
Yes, Quackenbush. Yeah. Oh, we always thought when our darling Edith Quackenbush married Clarence Pitkin, her life would just be over. I mean, she'd be married and
settled
and everything, and that would be it.
She was quite a dynamo around here, I gather.
Oh, she was just darling, and we loved her as a teacher. So, anyhow, where was I?
You were doing a play for school.
And they needed a youngster for the play. They needed two, a little boy and a girl. And they decided that I would play the part. That was really quite a thing to be in the senior play. And I can't remember the boy's name. But anyway, his wife was helping with the makeup. And she talked to me, asked me my name. And I was a friend of another little girl, Dorsey Cole, Dr. Cole's daughter. And she asked me, was I by any chance the Lorna that she had talked about? And yes, I was. I was the only Lorna in town. And she said that this little girl, Dorsey Cole, always spent some time with them in the summertime because Dr. Cole and Frank R. Adams were such good friends. And she had lost her mother. And the little girl had. And would I like to come down and visit them? Now, I'd heard of Sylvan Beach, but we didn't have a car, nor did we have a boat. Whitehall people just didn't come down there. It was a dirt road. And,
I see. So South Shore was just a dirt road at that time?
I don't think it was paved till 1921.
I'll be darned. So it's just like a single lane, just dirt, rutty road? It's just mud?
Mud, yeah. And probably gravel on it, maybe some places. And it goes back to that. So she went to talk to my parents, and they allowed us how, yes, I could come down with Dorsey Cole.
Was Murray Road paved at that time? Was the road coming into Sylvan Beach paved at all at that time?
No.
Same thing.
That's how Dr. Cole got to be one of Frank's best friends, because he saved his life. Frank had a car. And there was a very bad place out here in the desert that with drifting sand, and the road was hard to get through. And he promoted in the township two strips of concrete across that bad place, and he got out himself and worked with the men to put that in. Had a sunstroke. And Dr. Cole, we always said Dr. Cole saved his life, which he probably did. But anyway, Frank Adams would do most anything. Spend an awful lot of time writing, of course. So I saw Sylvan Beach for the first time. This is before World War I, and I don't know whether it was 1915 or maybe 16. And then, of course, both Frank and Dr. Cole got into the service in World War I. And went over to Chicago, and I'm just talking about Frank R. Adams, but of course he was the most famous man in these here parts.
Oh, certainly. Well, I want you to believe me. I want this.
And they went to officers' training camp, and then he went to France, and as Dr. Cole did as a medico, and Frank was just enlisting. He didn't give a darn what, but he had to get in the war. Mm-hmm. And the line was so long in the army, and the, what branch did he, artillery line wasn't so long. So he moved from the army line over to artillery and enlisted in artillery. And ended up teaching in France, teaching every American company that came through with tanks and American things, because he loved motors and new motors.
I'll be darned. He knew a lot of. He was into many different things, wasn't he?
Yes, he was. Uh huh. Well, he had the car he took apart. This great big gray, can't remember the name of it, a 7-passenger car. Mm-hmm. And he'd take it apart every year, the motor apart, and put it back together again. Leave it up here in Michigan, in the house, in the Vandeventer house.
Okay.
Of course, we always call that the big house. Well, Peg was she wasn't married from that house, but we all dressed there. I was a bridesmaid for Peg.
Now, what year was that approximately that Peg was married? What year approximately?
Well, of course, she'll tell you. 25, I think.
Okay, about 25.
Yeah, but get that from Peg.
Okay. Well, back to the First World War with Frank. He was over there for what? The year that we were in it? Was he
the whole time we were in it.
Yeah. Did he see any action with the artillery?
Oh, yeah. No, not any action.
Well, thank you.
But he taught about the motors and artillery. And he wanted action, but he didn't get it because it happened that he had
other talents.
Yeah.
Thank goodness for that.
The people who did the tanks in those days had a cottage at Sylvan Beach.
Well, who was that? Who made the tanks?
Yeah, down in the, but it was farm equipment.
Right.
And, of course, I've known their names, and from Dave Forbes' book, I could get the name.
You don't remember the name, but they made the tanks, for the tanks for the First World War.
Yeah.
Did you know Andrew Courtney Campbell?
Oh yes, he was in. Yes, of course, he was older than. We were. Now, the girls that I... Well, then, every summer after that, the Adams would have me down.
Okay.
So, let's see, Peg and I were friends from the beginning. Carmi Guerin and I, albeit Carmi was older than I. You knew Carmi Guerin. Mm-hmm. And she died this... Well, January, I think.
Oh, boy.
Of this year at 95. And now you might not have known Lucille Norris, Lida, because after they sold their cottage, which was next to the hotel but one, and I don't know who has the cottage now, and then married and had a cottage down here on White Lake. Lou Lida, she married a doctor. That was.
I can remember that name, Lida, from the old yacht club, New News and things.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
Yeah. Lida, right.
And Helen Bell Merriam, she lived on the White Lake side. Well, she was Helen Bell then. Who was the fifth? Peg. Lorna, Helen, Carmi. Well, we organized ourselves, these five. Well, how silly, I can't remember. And that's something that happens as you get older. And the names of things. I get back here and can't remember the name of an nasturtium. Well, of course, I do flowers out there, too. I used to be a terrific gardener, a flower gardener. And I know the names of everything out in San Diego. Then I get back here and can't even remember, as I say, a petunia. I know them, but I can't remember the words. This is age, of course. We formed ourselves a club. We called ourselves the Filthy Five because we went to Whitehall and See, I was with the Adams then.
Okay.
And, of course, I adored her. Well, in fact, she's responsible for my being with them. Mm-hmm. They never had children. And went to Wido's in Whitehall, which was a men and boys clothing store. And we bought overalls. Now, not blue jeans, but the kind, well, there wasn't such a thing as the blue jeans, uh-huh. The same material, but they had a bib and suspenders. So we bought boys' overalls and decided we would wear these overalls. We introduced them. We'd wear the Filthy Five, we called ourselves, and Peg and I are the only two left of the Filthy Five.
What'd you two do? I mean, what did you all do?
Oh, we didn't do much of anything. Nobody had cars. The Adams had a car.
Mm-hmm.
And we swam in the afternoon and played tennis and did all the things on the beach. We had a dance every at the WAB Club every Wednesday and Friday, Wednesday and Saturday. And we had a orchestra for the from the University of Illinois who came up and stayed. And lots of people, as well, this would be after 21, after the road was paved, would come up from Muskegon to the dances.
Mm-hmm.
But that was quite a thing to do. I mean, that took care of two nights. And we'd have our own parties, you know, just as kids do now. So.
Did you drink back then?
No.
No, there was other. Well, that was prohibition then, about that period came in, about 1990.
Yeah, but we didn't. No, we weren't drinkers at all. Not until we got older.
you were just having good fun, huh?
Yeah.
So Mrs. Adams was kind of responsible then for you being down here, Frank?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. of course, he was running the theater. This is just summertime, you see.
I was about to ask you, this was just kind of a fun thing for him to do in the summer. He ran the theater here.
He, ran and booked all the movies. And they finally took me to California with them.
Just took you along for the...
Yeah. It was, my parents moved to Muskegon during the war. And so I had the last of... My last 3 years of high school in Muskegon. And he was in pictures then. Frank was writing movies then. In fact, there was a Frank R. Adams production at Paramount. I mean, it just Paramount would buy his stories and he would write the screenplays.
Oh, wow.
And Trix's mother lived up in Santa Barbara, so Trix and I were up there. He'd come up weekends when he could.
Uh-huh.
And just bit by bit, I'd be with them more and more, and eventually until she died. She died at a rather, well, to me, at such an early age, her late 40s.
What did she die of?
She was out in California visiting her mother in the summertime. Mm-hmm. And got sick and died. That was quite a tragic thing. But Frank knew I could do, because I'd helped him once in the West. Because in high school I'd taken typing and shorthand, and I was very good at both of them. Only because I was with grown-ups, because I was with them so much, I think I could still do shorthand, but I'd be with older people, those two, because she was a couple years younger than he, but he was 20 years older than I was. And I'd take down conversations with my forefinger in shorthand for no reason. Not I wasn't trying to improve my shorthand or anything. It just got to be automatic. Mm-hmm. So one time he was kind of desperate when he came up, when Trix and I were up in Santa Barbara, and he drove up, somebody 90 miles north of Hollywood. And because he needed to do publicity for the theater in Whitehall, he needed to do letters for bookings of pictures, and he was going to have to spend his weekend doing that because he'd been so busy at the studio, he hadn't had time to do it. So I rather shyly asked, could I help? I do shorthand and typing. And he was so surprised. He always called me kid. She always referred to me as mine kid.
Mine kid.
Just mine kid.
German background there.
I don't know how that happened. And he just called me kid. And he was so grateful, and I did. I took his letters down in shorthand and the bookings and the publicity. And that's how, in later years, when he was desperate for help after Trix had died, I came back. He had a male, always had... He had a male secretary. No, he didn't always have, but he had two different ones. And both very intelligent young men. He'd send them to college, both of them out of Whitehall. The first one was Paul Snell, and they had a grocery in Whitehall. And Frank sent him to business school and took him out to Hollywood. Frank always drove out there. Trix and I always went on the... And got him a job at Paramount and had told him, even then, that he was too smart just to be a secretary or too capable. And he got him a job at Paramount, and he got to be head of publicity in later years, I mean, through the years. And Lloyd Carlson lived in the country, and he got to be Frank's secretary. And then Frank put him in the garage in Whitehall, the M11 garage.
I see. Okay.
Which
is that? Where is that building now? What building is that?
It's across the street from the across the street from Dr. Engstrom and Barnes.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. That's the RPM, or that's that stone building with the. Is it that brick building, the white one now that's painted white, and it's the hunting bait shop?
I don't know what it is now. You see, I've been back such a short time, and
so he put him into there, right? He put him in business there.
Yeah. Well, yes, he apparently had money in the garage. He was always helping people out with loans, and then in turning up... ending up owning, you know.
Part of the...
When the loans...
The
yeah. So, anyway, that was Frank Adams. And then... And... It was about 4 years after Trix died that he came to my mother... in Muskegon, my father had died in the meantime, to ask if as I say, he had the mail secretary. That would have been Lloyd Carlson. But he had so much fiction to do under contract that he was just desperate. And could I come up and help him? And he said, of course, he had a cook. And he said, that'll be, who lived in the house, that's the big house. So she'll be chaperoned, but she can't go back and forth from Muskegon, I mean.
Yeah.
So he would dictate to me all morning, and I would transcribe all afternoon. And he'd dictate to Lloyd all afternoon, and he would transcribe the next morning. Well, what it was two different stories, two different books he was doing that he was under contract for and had to do.
And he just dictated as he
went. Yeah, and eventually he just decided he guess he couldn't get along without Lorna.
I'll be darned. When did he propose to you?
Well, it was after that sometime. And I adored him, of course, from the time I was a kid.
Yeah.
Albeit I'd gotten engaged to somebody else in one of the Middletons. And
which
it was not it wasn't on account of, that was when Trix was living.
Uh-huh.
And
which Middleton?
Well, it would be Peggy Dilly's uncle.
Okay. I don't know who that is, but we'll be able to narrow that down.
Don't you know Peggy Dilly?
Oh, yes, I do. Yes, I do.
And Dorothy...
Dorothy Middleton?
Dorothy Brewer?
Brewer?
Yeah, her uncle.
Okay, her uncle.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Okay, yeah. So then Frank proposed to you, though.
Oh, yeah. Oh, but Frank had nothing to do with my engagement. I mean, that was while Trix was still living I got engaged to Bill. And then decided not to get married. But Frank had nothing to do with that.
Yeah.
I was very fond of him, but I was living in his house and never would have dawned on. Besides, he was an older man, you know.
20 years older, as you said.
20 years older.
Yeah. And so... what happened? What happened? Did you know that he was going to ask you, or?
Oh, I guess I kind of thought
so. You had the wrong end, Mrs. Lenoy, the wrong end there area. You kind of sensed that it was coming.
Well, we had so much in common.
Yeah.
And I'd lived in the family so long. He was just so used to me. I was just so used to him too, really, by that time, after I'd worked with him with Lloyd, because that took quite a while, like a question of 2-3 months.
Now, what year did this happen? What year did he ask you to marry him?
Nineteen thirty.
Where did you?
We were married in 1931.
Okay. Whereabouts were you?
In New York.
In New York, I'll be darned.
Mm-hmm.
Whereabouts in New York? Do you remember? Was it at a church? Was it?
No. It was a. I went to New York as his secretary, really, with him.
Uh huh.
And I was at the Astor, and he was at the Lambs Club. And we went down to, we were married by, well, what do you call it? A civil marriage.
Justice of the Peace.
In New York City, in Manhattan.
Okay. What did you do on your... honeymoon, where'd you go? Or did you have a honeymoon at all? Or
we came back to Michigan And his mother was still living. His mother. Well, her mother was too. Her mother lived in Santa Monica, and he was very fond of her. And his mother lived in L.A. So he, and of course she was so tickled because she was so fond of me. She was so tickled that I had married Frank. Well, anyway, we were going for 2 weeks, so we left the cook and the chow dog, which I'd spent a lot of my life walking, and which, and I owe my good health to that dog, I think.
What was the dog's name, do you remember?
Woo, W-U.
W-U, Woo. What type of dog was it?
Chow.
Chow, okay.
Chinese chow. Yeah. We had two different ones.
So you came up here.
So we went to... he'd always driven to L.A. with his mail secretaries. But he and I drove, of course we were married then, drove to L.A. And we were only going to be gone 2 weeks, so we left the cook and the dog. And because we were just visiting his mother and seeing Jetty Trix's mother. Her name had been Jed before she married Frank. And somehow he got hooked on an MGM contract. And that was in 31 or 32. I'm a little mixed up there about...
No problem.
And so he wanted me to work with him at MGM. And I always wanted to work with him. And, but I didn't want to work with him as his wife. I wanted to work with him as Lorna Margrave under my own name because I didn't want to, well, I wanted to, if I was going to be a secretary, I wanted to be one of the secretaries at the studio, not the wife of a writer. Mm-hmm. Well, they eventually found out that we were married.
But you got in there under Margrave then at first.
Yeah.
Who were some of the stars that you ran into during that period?
Oh, Lordy, I can't even remember the titles. We worked on so many. They put him under contract because his dialogue in his fiction was always utterly charming. And it was for dialogue. Well, when they got him under contract, they didn't have a picture for him. But they needed a writer for the Johnny Weissmuller picture. So that was the first picture we worked on.
Was that a Tarzan, Johnny Weissmuller? Oh, you wrote the screenplay for the first Johnny Weissmuller?
No, it wasn't the first Johnny Weissmuller. It was just one of them.
One of the Tarzan movies.
But they didn't have they just wanted to put him to work because they'd hired him, and of course a pretty fancy salary. So, anyway, that was the first thing. And that was most interesting to me because we got in touch with so many animals. Now, there were three monkeys... Three chimpanzees. And we got to know the owner of the three chimpanzees that played the one part. Because each one could do something different. Oh. I'm telling you the story of my life. You don't want that.
Oh, I certainly do. You keep going. This is just what I want. You just keep on telling me about it. And then we'll...
So we got to know the owner of the chimps. And one of the chimps liked me very much. It was as big as I was. I weighed about 100 pounds then. And I took the chimp in to lunch at the MGM commissary one day. And the two of us sat at the counter. And he had eaten at the counter before.
Uh-huh.
But his owner said, well, I was going to lunch. We were on the set working, and I wasn't needed at the time, and so take I used to know their names, all of them, but it was the one I took to lunch. And he was served a basket of stale biscuits and a cup of coffee. And I had a sandwich. And he dunked his biscuits in the coffee and slurped them in. Chimps have the most beautiful hands, like a human hand. Long, graceful fingers. He'd steal my cigarettes, and he'd take my cigarette and smoke it right down and then flip it away so gracefully. This one particular chimp.
Do you think they're very intelligent? Chimps are pretty intelligent.
Oh, I think they are.
They are too, yeah. Yeah, I think a lot of the animals are, and we don't give them any credit.
And then we knew the young man that owned the lion, that played the lion in the Tarzan stories.
Do you recall the name of the Tarzan film that you worked on?
No, there were several of them. I knew them all the time, but who would remember those? In fact, I got so sick and fed of seeing too many movies, because not only did we have to see all the MGM pictures, but other studio pictures too. And I had loved the movies. But I got pretty fed. You hardly can get me to a movie now, and I would no more watch one of the old ones on
TV at all.
But we got to know very interesting. I did. He too, of course, Frank too.
Who was the co-star with Johnny Weissmuller, the female at that time?
Well, she was a darling. Now, what was her name? You know, I can't even go back. That's 60 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Wasn't Dorothy Lamour?
No, she was later.
Yeah. Was Johnny Weissmuller a very nice man?
He was all right.
Do you remember some of the other stars that you met with MGM and you and Frank met? Did you become friends with any of the stars?
Well, Joan Crawford, for one.
What did you think
when
of Joan Crawford?
Well, she was under contract to MGM.
Did you like her?
Oh, yeah. And that even... Penny was born in 35.
Okay.
And I got pretty rotten spoiled because all Frank's friends, the writers and directors and everything, were all older than I. And here I was pregnant and Frank was going to have his first baby. And so, as I say, I got a little rotten spoiled.
A lot of flowers and everything.
Oh, God.
Who were some of the other stars that you knew?
Well,
that you liked or whatever. That you
way back when Trix was still living, Bill Hart, William S. Hart.
William S. Hart. Okay.
Got to be dear friends. Oh. I slapped his face once.
Why?
Well, because he and Frank had a bet. We were very good. He lived across the street from us. And through my walking the dog, I got to be a friend of his. And then Frank and Trix got to be friends of his. He wasn't married at the time. His sister lived with him. And she had to wear a collar. She'd been in an accident, but she was a darling. Well, he and Frank had a bet. Frank bet his about a location of some place in California. And, of course, Bill Hart was off the New York stage before he got so popular. He was about 6 feet two. And he was before Tom Mix and...
I remember William S. Hart.
I got a lot of pictures of him. I've got them all put away now. Well, I got, he bet his hat, the hat he'd worn in his first 14 pictures, which was a beaver, a beautiful cowboy hat, but real beaver, with a snakeskin
rim,
thing
around the...
Some fan had made, that a rim around the hat.
Yeah.
And, Frank bet him his war gun, whatever gun he'd brought back from
First World War.
And Bill called one day and said, Frank is going to get my hat. I'm losing the bet because I found out he's right about the send Lorna over now. So I went over just across the street, Kitty Corner, and Bill had this big, beautiful hat, which I still have. And he put it on my head and tipped my face up and then kissed me. Now, he didn't mean a thing by that, but nobody had ever kissed me that way, so I didn't know what to do, so I hauled off and slapped his face.
Oh,
that amused him.
That
amused him so.
And you still have...
Well, I looked so darn young, and I was. For such a long time, I looked much too young. Because I was little. I mean, I was not only short, but I was slender too. Yeah. As I say, I weighed about 100 pounds. And if that much, I remember trying to get up to 100. But that amused him highly.
And you still have his cowboy hat, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Boy, one of these days, if you find that, I'd like to tape that just to get a little tape of that. You know, put a film it.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be nice if you ever found it. What other stars did you hang around with and you and Frank hang around with and know?
Hang around so much with the stars.
As much as the directors?
Directors and other writers.
Mm-hmm.
Because the stars aren't...
They have their own class system type?
No, but they aren't... Well...
Go on.
They aren't literary people.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
What was Frank's favorite director?
Leo McCarey. And Leo had started out as a director. He was a wild Irishman and a delight. He had started out as a director of Hardy and...
Laurel and Hardy. I'll be
darned. And then got to directing other things. And then he and Leo were working on a picture together. And they wanted to get away, both of them, and still work, but... So they would go to a ranch, a dude ranch, and I would go with them. And at the dude ranch, I got to know a lot of the actors, like Joan Crawford, who was married to French O'Toole at the time, and... Our most favorite was Frances Marion, who was a writer, and she had 3 Oscars. Mm-hmm. And well, it was through her that MGM got to know we were married, because she kept inviting Frank to her parties, and he'd always make an excuse.
Okay.
You know. And finally, he said, well, because they had known each other for years. And he finally said, well, I'll tell you the honest truth, Frances, that I am married to Lorna. Well, she came into his office. Well, I had one office attached to his, but she had in MGM. You had to go through my office to get to Frank. Had to go through me to get to Frank. And she came in one day, and I had read movie magazines. I had read movie magazines from the time I was a kid, and then had done publicity with Frank, you see, for the movies.
Right, work.
And so I knew her name very well. She was a beautiful woman. And she came into the office, and unfortunately, Frank was in conference. And she said to me, "Well, where did he get you?" And I said, "Well, actually, he got me in Whitehall, where he spends his summers. And I worked for him up there." And that was all there was to that. Well, she said, but she sat down and talked to me, and I was fascinated by her because I had read so much about her in the movie magazines. So later she came back. She left a message for Frank. And later she came back, and when Frank was there, and he had told her that we were married then. So then we got to go to all her parties. One time was, well, Mary Pickford was at the party. Mary Pickford was a close friend of hers because Frances had been in the movies since she was 17 years old. She was a writer, but she also was a beautiful woman. And, of course, she knew everybody. But this particular night, Charlie Chaplin was there, and Mary Pickford was there, and lots of others.
Was she Mary Pickford married then to Douglas Fairbanks?
No, by this time, maybe she was. I don't remember him. I never met him.
Maybe she was there and Charlie Chaplin was there?
Yeah. And a famous singer who made records, John McCormick. And they, Chaplin and McCormick did the cutest thing. McCormick played the piano, and Chaplin just opened a magazine and sang what was in the magazine to the tune that...
That he was playing on the piano.
Yeah, that the singer himself was playing on the piano. It was the cutest thing. Well, he was charming. Chaplin, I had met him before because I was walking the dog on Sunset Boulevard, and nobody had a chow except us. Mm-hmm. And, of course, they are gorgeous dogs. And this was a magnificent animal. And... everybody getting from Hollywood, the studios, back. I'm looking in the mirror because I'm seeing the boats that are going by.
Oh, yeah, boat being towed there. Yeah. So I wonder what you were looking at.
Everybody, to get to Beverly Hills, had to go down Sunset Boulevard, and I was walking the dog on Sunset Boulevard from where I would go up into the mountains with the dog. And you know the big Hollywood sign that you see on TV all the time?
Yeah, on the side of the hill. Yeah.
Well, in those mountains was where I used to walk the dog. With that great, huge, the letters were as tall as this room.
Uh-huh.
Enormous. I didn't walk under the letters, but it was in that area.
Oh, you're right, okay.
But I was on Sunset Boulevard, and he pulled the car... The chauffeur pulled the car up, and he opened the door and got out and said, "Is that a dog or a cinnamon bear?" And I, of course, I knew who he was.
Oh, sure, Charlie.
And so I said, it's a Chinese chow. Well, what makes his tongue so purple? Chows have deep purple tongues. Has he been eating blueberries? I'll bet you 50 people during that dog's life asked me what makes his tongue so blue. But they all have that dark blue tongue. Well, anyway, we talked and
I'll be darned. That's how you first met Charlie Chaplin?
Yeah.
That
is wild. So when I saw him this time at Frances Marion's party, he just said, "You're the little girl with the dog."
He was a very gracious man, then, it sounds like.
Oh, yeah. Oh, they were all pleasant, nice people. I didn't know any people that were, didn't know any people that weren't. But with Leo McCary, the director, we would go up to Pebble Beach and play golf at Pebble Beach when it was an 18-hole golf course. Well, I guess it's still only 18 holes, but now they play the Crosby tournament, so you know, and you see those on TV all the time. Mm-hmm. Well, there was a herd of what kind of animals on the first green? Oh, like deer. Like cows? Deer, no.
Oh.
Oh, no, no.
Like deer, huh? Like,
Well, they might, they were deer of some kind, or that family. And frequently they'd be in your way on the first hole. And one time, and I almost saw that happen again, because I watched the golf tournament, because I love golf. Don't play it, of course, anymore, but love golf. Frank overshot the green on one of the ocean holes, and we thought his ball had gone down into the rocks and down to the ocean. And we were, oh, what a shame, you overshot it. And the ball had hit a rock and came back up. It didn't go into the hole. That would have made a better story.
It's still amazing.
But the same thing happened in some tournament I was watching, and that didn't go in the hole either, but it bounced back. And that was 60 years ago. Well, 60-some, 50-some maybe. Well, let's talk about Sylvan Beach.
Well, I just want to finish that up there. How long, what years were you in Hollywood with Frank? 31 to
early 40s.
Early 40s. Did you know, let's see, any of the directors of, I'm trying to think of.
King Vidor. What, King Vidor was
there. Oh, wow, you knew, okay.
And his wife was Florence, she was an actress.
I guess by that time, too, Bob Hope was out there, and people like that.
No, it was before Bob Hope's time.
Uh-huh. Okay. When you left there, yeah. Yeah, okay, well, back to that's fascinating, and believe me, this is all important part
well,
of history.
Well, Frank got fed and bored, and I did, too. Well, we were guests of W.R. William Randolph Hearst up at
San Simeon. Yeah. What was Mr. Hearst like?
He was darling to me.
I'll be darling.
Mm-hmm. And now here's another case where I looked so darn young. The first time we were up there, the living room, of course, was, well, I'd say half a block long. There was a piano at each end of it. And we had the most magnificent. Frank was working on a picture for Marion Davies.
Okay.
And it was the cocktail hour. And we were all in the this great, long, huge, quite a bunch of us, and serving cocktails. Well, he took me, W.R., took me up to the bar and said, I've got something I want you to taste. And it was some dated, fabulous wine, I think. I wasn't much of a drinker. In fact, Frank had taught me to drink. If I was going to drink, I'd drink like an officer and a gentleman. So he taught me, he would make martinis. That's what I started drinking. Yeah, I'm a scotch and water now. But I still like martinis. But anyway, this might have been an 18-something, you know, And he had the bartender pour some in the glass for me because he wanted me to taste it. And I knew not a darn thing about liquors or about wines or anything else, but I took a taste and it was good. And he said, "Well, what do you think of that?" And not knowing what else to say, I said, "That is really something, isn't it?"
And
got away with it.
You pulled it off.
Well, he'd always be around when we were shooting on the picture. Of course, San Simeon was a fabulous place then.
Now,
still
you've
is.
You've been there a couple times, you said. So you've been there, you've yeah. up there several times.
Yeah.
Now, Mr. Hurst was a friend of Frank's.
Frank had worked for him Well, he was working on the picture at the time. But he had worked for him in a newspaper in Chicago, and he wrote for Hearst magazines, one of them being Cousin Pollen. And so they, of course, knew each other.
When when you were up there, were you one of many guests, among many guests? Or?
One of the times, and then another time, there were very few of us. When he and Frank and the director, they disappear into like a paneling in the wall. There's an elevator up to up at San Simeon, this one. They just kind of disappear through that sliding panel and disappear. Well, they'd be up in Hearst's office, so we the few of us that were around would have to entertain ourselves, because the men would be working, you see.
Those were working type of things, almost weekends, working weekends.
No, they weren't weekends. They were just
any period of time.
Yeah, yeah. So, and then when we were shooting on the MGM lot, Hearst was always there, and we always sat together. Bored stiff, well, I was anyway, because they do the scenes over and over, you know, the way they do.
But you found Mr. Hearst to be a very
But he was awfully nice to me, always very nice to me. Everybody's always been awfully nice to me.
Did you ever see Mr. Hearst when he wasn't nice to, when he was on somebody or mad
no,
at somebody?
No, no, no.
So he's generally just a very nice
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
Did you know Veronica Lake or anybody like that?
No, I could identify her, I think, and that's...
Did Mr. Hearst own part of MGM, or did he own MGM, or what?
He must have had
some sort of
something to do with it, because... Marion Davies' pictures were shot there, you see.
Yeah, which is one, yeah.
And she was a darling.
Was she, Mary?
Oh, yeah.
That's exciting. That is very exciting. And so about 1942, you all got kind of fed up with the Hollywood scene.
Yeah, Frank did have to go back a couple times. In the meantime, Ed Wilson... who built all those little cottages over on White Lake, the builder. And Frank owned 250 feet down here. I don't know, he just, probably someone just offered it to him and he bought it. How he happened to own it, I don't know. Had owned it for years. But Ed came to him, the builder, and said, Frank, you've got that property down on White Lake. Why don't you let me build you a cottage to rent? And Frank said, for God's sake, Ed.
Whoops. Oh, it's just a little sound in the camera.
Oh, oh.
Hopefully it's nothing.
For God's sake, Ed, I'm not in the rental business. And Ed said, well, you've got all that property down there, and it's such nice property. I wish you'd let me build a house to rent. And Frank said, by any chance, do you need the money? And Ed said, well, I'd like to keep my men working. And Frank said, well, okay. Ed said, I'd build you a cottage. I forget what he was going to charge him. I'll build you a cottage for a certain amount. And Frank said, okay, Lorna and I'll draw you up a plan. So we drew up a plan, which is no more like this. Well, this house I've changed so much. In fact, I've put wings everywhere, but it started out as a rental cottage. Never rented it. We went over to Marshall Fields and bought all the furniture for it, and we're ready to rent it. Well, we were having house guests, and quite a few at the big house, and Frank said, why don't we leave the cook here and go down and try out the cottage? Well, he went swimming every night before he went to bed up there. And we came down, leaving our guests up there, but we were up there all the time. But we stayed down here at the cottage. And it was sunshine, no trees. It was desert. Of course, we called it the desert down here, you know.
So this was all just flat land here then at that time.
Yeah, mm-hmm. From the hairpin turn, all of this.
Oh, but not just dunes.
These dunes, not a scrub stuff.
Scrub stuff, yeah.
But all these trees and everything were not here. And Frank could go swimming before he got dressed in the morning, because there was a dock going right down the center of that terrace. And then every night on the hot nights, he always went swimming before he went to bed. Mm-hmm. And he was just crazy about living down here. Well, there were 1, 2, 3, 4 bedrooms, and it was just kind of an oblong building. Uh-huh. 4 bedrooms. This was Frank's office, this part of the house. Well, the first thing I designed and added was a library. You're running out of...
No, we're fine. I was just looking at the tape, and I've got another tape, so you just keep talking. So you added a library?
Yeah. The living room started here somewhere and went that-a-way.
Okay.
So, and we had a book wall where that permanent wall is now.
Okay.
That was put in after, years later. Mm-hmm. And then after that, there's a library. There's a room there that got to be Frank's office when I changed the living room around. And a library up from there, a small room with a fireplace, and it's lined with books. We happen to have a few books, a few thousand. And then added to the bedroom on that side, took the wall out, and made a bigger room out of that up the same 2 steps. Now that's my bedroom and bath now. And out of the maid's room, half of it is a pantry and half of it is my bath over there. Our bath, it was Frank's and mine, of course. Okay. That was the first one. And then the kitchen ended. And I thought it'd be nice to have a breakfast room with a great big window so I could look out on, because I was had gotten to be a gardener.
Uh-huh.
And so all that lawn that you saw, which had just been, the mowers had just left when you came.
Okay.
Which was a good thing because there are 2 mowers and Seaver's sister who comes with her tool and goes all around the edges, you know, the electric thing. And they come in a truck which is dragging their mowers and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And you couldn't have gotten in the driveway because they park it.
Right.
I told you there was nothing going on Tuesday. So all morning, Bill Tolan from Whitehall, you know him?
No, not really.
Came to put on my screens. After that hot day last Thursday.
Yeah. And this Thursday is supposed to be 100 degrees, or 95
is it?
Degrees. Yeah, Thursday.
Well, fortunately, there was a window, an Anderson window in the breakfast room. That's the next thing I put on, the breakfast room and the lobby laundry room that you came through when you came in.
Okay.
And then during World War II, I put on that beautiful porch, a closed porch.
Okay.
I mean, big windows and everything, but we call it the porch. That's the length of this room and a bedroom that's in there. So it's a 10-room house now.
Goodness. When did you decide to move down here permanently?
Because Frank liked it so well.
And what year was that, approximately, that you sold the big house and then finally came down here?
It was shortly after we were married, I think.
Oh, okay. Okay, so you sold that about...
I don't know when I remember, Bill...
About 32 or 3, then.
Get that from Peg.
Okay. Okay, I'll find it.
Now, he only would have sold it to Peg and Bill.
Okay.
Because, of course, Peg was my...
One of the filthy five.
One of my best friends from...
That's fascinating. Frank Adams, we can go back a bit here. Frank Adams, of course, did the Jinxes for years, and then your next husband, too, played the drums and the Jinx for as long as I could remember growing up.
Yeah.
Many years. Can you tell me some of the memories or the Jinxes, the Frank R. Adams Jinxes, maybe what years they were approximately?
Well, they were... He started them before World War I.
Okay.
And then in 1926 or 27, Trix and Frank and I were going to California winters. Frank was the president of the association for God knows how many years.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I didn't know that.
And that'll be in Dave Ford's book, which should be behind you. I had two copies. I had Earl's, and now his kids, Bill and Louise, Lano, and he's with P&G. They'll be up this weekend. Live in Cincinnati now. But in his first years, with early years, he was with P&G abroad or somewhere. I think both in Rome and Belgium,
mm-hmm.
and Brussels. And when his kids grew up into high school years, he applied to get back to America.
Okay, this is...
And so they live in Cincinnati. That is where P&G is.
Dr. Gamble, yeah, it is, yeah.
Yeah. And he's been going to retire. Told me he's going to retire last fall. They're darling with me. Oh, they're so sweet.
Now, these are Earl's children? Earl?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Earl had two children, Bill and Marva.
Okay.
You were around, weren't you?
Oh, vaguely. It was pretty young then. Pretty young. Your first recollection, then, of the Jinxes, why did Frank do them? When did he start doing them, and what prompted him to do this?
Well, because he'd written musical comedies professionally.
Uh-huh.
And they had started doing a little show, I think, in 1909, which he had nothing to do with. And that would be all people you, now, the people Peg would know.
Right.
And honest to Pete, that was the first. And it's J-I-N-K-S, it's not J-I-N-X.
That's how I had a question, yes, J-I-N-K-S.
And he just, it was a fun thing to do in the summer.
So he just decided to go ahead and just do it?
Well, people forced him into it, shall we say.
Okay, and that was about 1909, you said?
Well, no, let's see, he didn't even do the first one in 1909, and probably from then on he did.
Okay, so it was right after.
Yeah.
I understand they were quite the shows, that the costumes were flowing in and all.
It oh, yeah.
Very, very professionally done.
Oh, yeah.
Did he get friends coming up here from show business to help
him? Earlier he did, uh-huh.
Who were some of the personalities that he had up
here? Well, now, in my time, you wouldn't know the names even.
Try me.
Someone of the Barrymore family who wasn't a Barrymore.
Okay.
Was their house guest. This was before my time.
Uh-huh.
And played a part in the Jinx. Now, what's the other Barrymore name? The other...
Lionel and John?
No, I don't mean that family. No, John was in some of his at least one of his musical comedies.
Okay.
But that, of course, was in the big theater.
The big theater, yes.
Oh, it's terrible the way I can't remember names anymore. And besides, you're too young. You wouldn't remember them anyway.
So he did bring up a few personalities then from
oh, yeah.
business.
Oh, yeah.
Would be in the show.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Now, did he write all those songs, or, I mean, he would write the songs that would be in the...
He wrote a lot of them.
A lot of them.
Uh-huh.
And I understand, well, I mean, we all know that he wrote the words for Gangway for the Sylvan Beach Gang, which was...
No, he didn't. Marion Runyon wrote those, I think.
Marion Runyon, okay. I'll be darned. I always heard that Frank Adams wrote that from...
Well, maybe he did. He wrote a lot of them.
Yeah, and that was to the tune of In the Mountain Greenery, as I recall.
Yeah.
Well, we'll have to check. We'll have to figure that out. But
mm-hmm.
That's great. And so, now how many years did he do the Jinx then? Do you remember any?
Well, he was back in 1919, wouldn't he have been?
Okay.
When the war was over?
Over, be 19, yeah. So he started him up again about 1919?
Yeah.
And he went...
And he did him through 1926, I'm sure.
Okay. Did people have to try out to be in him? It wasn't like kids came down and everything like they do now, was it? It wasn't like that.
No, it weren't amateur things the way they are now.
Good.
Yeah, they were kind of... No, he tried to get all the kids in, and like little production numbers that would include the little ones, but not the little, not as little as they are now.
Now, okay.
And of course, I've got all the Jinx pictures, and they're put away.
Would it be possible someday to get those pictures out?
I can't even get the door open. Thank God. That closet, maybe you could open it.
Okay.
But you couldn't get the pictures out because I can't get them out, nor I...
You don't want to mess with it, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Is the hat in there too, Mr. Hart?
No.
No,
you
didn't? No. So, wrote the Jinxes till about 1926 then?
I think his last one was 26. Maybe it was 27, I'm not sure. Now I think Peg has all the pictures also. And, well, people have a way, and I have duplicates on an awful lot of them, because people have a way of clearing out grandma's things or their parents' things and thinking, well, I had something to do with the jinx, and they send the...
Yeah, they give them away, send them away, everything.
Or send them to me, thinking, you know, maybe I could... didn't have them.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I have tried to clear out that closet, and there's quite a few leftovers of magazines of Frank's stories in there that didn't go to the university, the 1,500 pounds. I only sent one of everything, you know.
Good for you.
And scripts, movie scripts and things that were here. Handwritten.
Are there any scripts left? Did you send them all, or?
I sent one of everything, and there would only be one of every script.
Yeah. To the University of Chicago.
No. The University of Oregon. Strangely enough, they had put in. The University of Michigan never asked for his stuff, nor did the University of Chicago. But the University of Oregon at Eugene, they put on a new edition and a new, it's a big school.
Mm-hmm.
And two men used to come down and see me in San Diego every winter I was there. I mean, every winter I have been there every winter since Frank died. To plead with me to do his
to send the stuff.
To send, and of course at first I said, well, he had no connection at all with Oregon. Well, that didn't make any difference. They wanted that sort of thing for their new writing course and their new building. Penny has been up there.
Okay.
Our daughter, Frank, and my daughter. You must know Penny, don't you?
I probably do, but it's, you know, I haven't seen her in years, probably. So.
Yeah, well, she's been very long term.
Well, that's fascinating. That's fascinating. Jeez, a name from the past around here that I'd kind of like to go into, Joe Sedoni.
Oh, gosh. The first year the Adams had me down. And as I say, I was in maybe seventh grade then, little kid anyway. And they were littler. They were very close friends of, we always called him Dota, the Big Joe, and Lily, and Art and Joe, Little Joe, were just little kids. And they came over to dinner one night, and I had heard in Whitehall about the Sedonis. And I met them for the first time, and I remember they were just darling little kids. They're only 15 months apart or something like that.
Uh-huh.
And they were so polite. And then we'd go over there and have dinner over to the Sedonis. So we saw a lot of the Sedonis.
What did you think of Mr. Sedoni? Was he, I understand he was a real character.
Oh, he really was. With Frank, they were just a couple of men that liked each other.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if Frank had any faith in his...
psychic powers?
Yeah. Except one day, I was crying about something, and I never cry. But something had hurt my feelings, and I was upstairs, and in the big house there was a phone upstairs. Well, Frank's office was upstairs, but it must have been empty because I answered the phone up there. And Joe Dodo had called me, and said, I don't want you to feel so bad. Stop crying. And at that point, I thought, gee whiz, how does he know, you know?
Wow.
He was just darling.
That's remarkable.
Uh-huh.
Well, that seems fairly psychic to me.
Yeah. Well, we saw a lot of them anyway, back and forth. The Sidonis and the Adams were good friends.
Very good friends.
Yeah.
With the Sidonis, did Frank Adams have anything to do with the stars that used to come up here and see Mr. Sidoni?
No, not really. I had nothing to do with Hollywood, you mean?
Mm-hmm.
No. Joseph Big Joe wrote to stars. And they got invited out one time. Now, do you know, of course, Joseph has just died. Do you know Art?
Yes, I do. He works over at the golf club now, doesn't he?
No.
Or he's around the golf club, I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He plays a lot.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I would like to get him on tape. I'm going to have to.
Yeah. Because he can tell you all about...
Okay. Pretty remarkable man, though, I gather. Do you remember, do you have any stories of how did the Depression affect you here at Sylvan Beach? Or do you have any memories of the Depression, things that happened?
No, it was during the Depression. I know a magazine that had bought a novel and was running it serially, and it was Carlson Palmer Red Book. Rather than pay him in a lump sum, and he got quite a lot of money for his writing, paid him by the month or something, which was most unusual.
Right.
That's something I remember. And
it's tough thing for everybody, it sounds like. The magazines were having a hard time, and everybody was having it.
And we never did get, we used to go to New York twice a year from here, and to see editors. And I did know the New York editors, you see, and they all were awfully nice to me. One of them, the first time Trix and Frank took me, well, the first time Trix and Frank took me to New York was my first trip to California. We left from California and went straight to New York before we came back here and bought the chow. Frank bought the chow and a car. And we drove from New York back here. That was my first long motor trip. Took us 5 days.
Oh, I bet you that was something else.
It really was.
I guess there were many roads that weren't even paved then that you had to go.
A lot, and the signs, the road signs. You'd go through every town.
What type of car was it? Do you remember what make or model it was?
Well, I remember it was a big car, that's all I remember. Kids aren't, and especially girls. Now, they are now, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And we know the names of the cars now.
Yeah, yeah.
But I remember when Frank was in the war, this big, I almost said it, this big, open, 7-passenger car, sat in the garage. It's a 2-car garage. Mm-hmm. Up on the hill. And there was, and they had a Ford. And the Ford had, Ford had to be cranked.
Okay. The old crank start, huh?
Yeah. And Trix drove the, during the war, drove the Ford. She never did drive the big car. And she could crank it.
Mm-hmm.
Reminds me of the story of Carmi Garin. There were 16 telephones on our line up there.
Okay, at the big band's house.
Yeah, 16 in Fruitland Township. I think the whole township was on the same line. And the Adams ring was too long and a short. Well, everybody knew the Adams ring, and so, of course, when they'd hear too long and a short, that was going to be something interesting, I presume. Frank was cranking that Ford. This was before the war. And the Garins were new up here. I don't know when they bought that house, but they were new before the war.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, they were old timers, who got to be. Mm-hmm. And Carmi is. And of course, he was a judge. Judge Carmi's father was a judge, Garin, from Chicago. And they had a telephone. So Frank was cranking the Ford and sprained his wrist. Maybe broke it, I don't know. And called Dr. Cole. And said that the car had kicked him. Or maybe the... whatever it was. It must have been Carr. Carmi was listening on the telephone. And she spread the word that Frank R. Adams was kicked by a cow and has a broken wrist.
Oh, geez. So people would pick up that phone when they heard the two longs and the short.
Yeah.
And they want to get the juicy stuff.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
People were wiretapping back then, even, weren't they? Listening in and eavesdropping.
Oh, you'd want to make an important call. This wasn't me, but you'd just take off the receiver and people would be talking. 16 people on the line, bound to be. And if you needed the phone, you would say, "May I have the line, please? I've got an important call."
Mm-hmm.
And everybody would get off.
I see. That's nice then. That was handy. That's wild. Can you remember, what are some of the most notable characters or famous people that you can remember besides Frank R. Adams and people like Joe Sedoni? Do you remember any characters that you thoroughly enjoyed up here in the Sylvan?
They taught me to play bridge, Frank and Trix did.
Uh-huh.
And I wasn't interested. But I didn't let them know that. And if they weren't doing anything in the evening, they would say, "Let's have a bridge game." And at that time, Paul Snell was his secretary, living in the house. And at dinner, Trix would say, "Well, let's play some bridge." And I got Paul off in the corner one time, and I said, "Look, if they suggest bridge tonight, tell them you have a date." So Trix suggested a game of bridge, and I waited for Paul to say something, and he... I said, "Okay." I could have killed him.
Yeah, you didn't like bridge very much.
But then I got to be a bridge player and played an awful lot of bridge. Now, you wouldn't know. Did you ever know Lucy Lee?
Oh, yes. I love Lucy Lee Jackman.
No, her mother.
Oh, no.
Her mother, Vera, Lucy Lee's mother, Vera Downing.
No, I did not.
Well, if you knew Lucy Lee, did you know Billy, too?
No, I didn't.
Her brother?
Billy who?
McDonald, Lucy Lee's brother.
You're right. Okay.
Well, the Middleton's cottage, the original Middleton cottage, was right behind the big house, now Peg's house. Okay. And Peggy Dilly lives there now, because she is a grandchild.
Right.
And V was a very good bridge player. So it got so that Frank and Trix and V and I played an awful lot of bridge. And I got to play a lot of bridge and enjoyed it. And always have since, so.
That's great.
And I loved V dearly.
Well,
I knew John Naveen, both the Naveens.
They were real characters, I understand.
The one that owned the big house that Charlie Spiegelmeyer worked on all the time, adding and adding to it. It's the minister owns it now.
Oh, yeah, the Edsons, Guggins, and then, it was the old Edson place during my period. It was Edson's, and then Ruth Guggins owned it. The Guggin family owned it, and then it was owned, okay.
Yeah.
It was there. Okay. Yeah, that place has been added to many times.
The Guggins I knew very well. In fact, I went with John Guggins, her brother, and Ruth was a dear friend, Ruth Guggins. And, but Senior Naveen, that was one of the jinks. We had costumes, I think, maybe that showed our knees.
Pretty racy.
So, the last night of and he didn't approve. Senior Naveen.
Uh-huh.
Because, of course, we were chorus girls. And we did all the dancing in the serious choruses, you know. We were all dancers. And those are a lot of the jinx pictures of the dancing choruses. And I think it was the last night of the show. We were boards over our shoulders for the encore. Came out with covering up our knees, you know.
Oh, we got very upset. Got upset enough that you had to change.
Well, everybody on the beach knew that he. But you see, we used to play Whitehall, the Jinx.
Oh, really? You go in town and play?
Yeah.
I'll be darned. This was back when? About what year?
Well, in the 20s sometime.
Okay. Where'd you play? At the Playhouse?
Theater. At the Newford Adams Playhouse, which is now how I'm at.
Okay. So you'd have one night down here, or two nights?
Two nights.
Two nights, and then you'd go in town.
I don't remember the order in which we did it. We went to some other theater up north one year, the whole cast.
But for many years then, the Jinx was also held in Whitehall.
No, never.
Oh, at the Playhouse. You said at the Playhouse?
Yeah, this one time.
Oh, okay. Okay, one time.
And I think maybe that was the time. No, it was always on the stage of the old
Wob Club.
Wob Club.
Right.
And how there was room for that club there.
Yeah, that's.
Is that hard to figure now?
The distance.
Of course, it was right on the road.
Road, yeah.
Well, Fruitland Township wouldn't let that happen now.
No, they certainly wouldn't. Well, I remember when the caretaker, Joel, I remember Jack Hansen, when I was growing up, would always be out on the road at night trying to direct the traffic.
Yeah, they had to.
So the children.
Of course, in those days, there wasn't much traffic.
Yeah, that's true, too.
But they've been going on every year. Someone has carried on the Jinx.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it was a dangerous place.
I used to have it.
Especially with little kids.
Yeah. That's true, too. Well, very much so. It was very dangerous. By the way, what year did Frank Adams die?
63. He had his 80th birthday in July, and he died in October.
Which brings me, how did you meet Earl then, or had you known Earl very long?
As a neighbor, to yell good morning or something. Frank, they were Muskegon people.
Uh-huh.
And they bought the cottage, and Bill tells me every year what year they bought the cottage, but the Jim Garrons owned it first. Now, that was the brother of Judge Garron.
Okay.
And Ed Wilson built the cottage.
Okay.
And so when we moved down here, it was the Jim Garron cottage. And the Lanowitz, well, I couldn't tell you, maybe in the 50s.
Okay, about the 50s then.
I don't know, this is a guess. Bill will remember. When you're this old, it's awfully hard to remember what year things happen.
I have a hard problem with my age, so.
Yeah, right. Right.
I understand.
You always have to connect things with something.
Association.
And so we were good neighbors. I'd bake fresh bread, which I loved to do. My mother taught me that. She taught me that in the 40s up here to bake bread.
Mm-hmm.
And then I taught our cook to bake bread. But I would... And then, let's see, my mother died in 45. Our cook died, one we'd had for years, in 45. And somebody famous died in 40.
Roosevelt died.
That was it.
In 45, yeah.
Because Penny came home from the Chittendens. And she'd been playing with Anne, and this was in April, I think. Locher's child.
Mm-hmm.
Did you know Locher?
No, now I know the name very well.
Uh-huh.
What he did.
You keep getting younger and younger.
Yeah. So, when did you marry Earl?
Let's see, after Frank died, I never was going to remarry.
Uh-huh.
And I was a widow 7 years.
Oh, good.
And I still would come back here and go back to San Diego. In the meantime, Penny and Ron Monroe had married. Now, Penny, my daughter Penny, is married to Ron Monroe, the son of the Monroe who was brought here to be superintendent of the schools in Whitehall.
Okay.
And the gymnasium is a William Monroe
mm-hmm.
gymnasium.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Penny is married to his son, Ron.
Okay.
And Ron was in the Navy. And Penny, of course, was born in Hollywood. And I think she was 2 years old before we... Yeah, that's one of the summers I missed. She was born February, and I've missed, of my 89 years on White Lake, I've missed two.
Well, that's not bad at all. That's great.
Isn't that something?
That's incredible. That is great. So you and Earl married.
Let's see. I was a widow 7 years. Frank taught Earl... gardening. Frank had a victory garden. In the sand out there, he had the most marvelous... Well, of course, he built it up with soil that was hauled in and everything, but, you know, we all had victory gardens during World War II. And Frank got a real started on his garden. And I'd bake bread. I'd take a loaf to Lila Spickelmeyer, or I'd take a loaf up to Doris Lanouette. because I always made more than and Frank adored homemade bread. I do too. And our plumber was a Montague man that was here quite often. I mean, anything that needed doing, he kind of like Bill Tolan, he'd come and do. And before the war, I had done the Gallup poll in this area.
I'll be darned. You were in charge doing the poll around here.
Yeah. As far as I would go, as I could go. Got to know a lot of the farm people because, for instance, I would have one or two wealthy person, one
poor.
Yeah, and in this area, so many farmers.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have a list of the people. I remember going to George Koval once, who was president of the bank when it was across the street.
Okay, from Pitkins, the Colby Bank?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Okay.
The original bank.
Bank.
In the original bank, I used to go in and go back and get the keys and unlock my own safe deposit box. Frank never carried much money. He and Guy Koval had a thing. Frank said he was the worst dressed man on the streets of Whitehall, and Guy Koval claimed, no, he was the worst. Well, Frank would go in to get cash, and George Koval or Hardy Esterdahl would say, Frank's going to have a haircut, give him some money.
Oh, that's wild. So the Koval, Mr. Koval owned the bank then, and that was the Koval, Mr. Koval ran the bank.
He was the president of the bank,
right,
there.
Right.
But there were several Kovals. Of course, there was George Koval and Mark Koval and Guy Koval and still one more.
Well, that'll probably come to you. Do you remember the Reverend Dowie?
No, my mother used to talk about him.
Okay.
Across the lake.
Lake, yeah, the guy that was always supposedly walked on the lake and everything.
Yeah,
else.
Yeah.
There was netting under there or something. But you don't remember that too.
No.
Do you remember the Carolina at all when it came?
Oh, I remember. The Carolina and the Georgia.
Uh huh. And
they would come in, of course, this was when we were in Whitehall, and stay all day Sunday at the foot of the main street in Whitehall,
right.
The dock that was there. In later years, when I was down here, I realized that the reason it stayed all day Sunday, it came up and stopped at the Michelinda dock, which is over at Lakeside, was.
Okay.
Stopped at Sohm Beach dock too. And the Chicago men would come up overnight and get here Saturday morning, the resorters.
Uh-huh.
And then the boat would go on to Whitehall and stay all day and all day Sunday. And then would come back and pick up, because that was the thing to do every Sunday night, to go down to Sohm Beach dock,
mm-hmm,
and see everybody off.
Watch them leave.
So that was an entertaining thing to do, you see.
Oh, yes.
I don't recall ever meeting the boat.
But you'd wait, everybody would watch it leave. Did you all sing or anything?
Oh, sure we did. And then we'd run over to the pier run down to the
Lake Michigan,
to Lake Michigan, and wave them off as they'd go through the channel. And then we'd go to any party. We were just, but
that was just an exciting. Well, that would be exciting for me to do now, even if I saw that happen. You know, saw a ship like that every week.
Yeah, and of course the ships to me seemed gigantic.
Mm-hmm.
And the first time I heard the Carolina or Georgia, I don't remember which one it was, in Whitehall, blow the horn, it was a sound I never had heard. And it was frightening.
Yeah, the big whistle of those things, yeah.
And it wasn't a whistle, it was really like a horn.
Hmm. And it carried very far, very, very loud.
Yeah.
I see.
But, it was on my, I don't know if it would blow when it was about to land or when.
Yes.
Well, it's something we got used to.
Yeah. Was it as loud as the tannery whistle? Didn't the tannery used to blow a whistle off?
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Yeah, that's... you know, back to Frank. Frank moved up here back, he moved back here in 1942, you said? Approximately 42, you left Hollywood?
Possibly, yeah.
Okay, after Frank left Hollywood, returned here, did he continue writing still for movies and magazines?
I think he only wrote one book. I think Frank was getting a little tired
of doing it, and he just wanted to enjoy life.
And, yeah.
And he'd saved enough, and he was quite a success, so he could enjoy life.
Uh-huh.
That's neat. That's neat. Did Earl Lonawet, he played the drums. Your second husband, Earl, played the drums in the Jinx for many years.
Yeah.
Do you remember when he started playing the drums in the Jinx?
He really studied drums. He was born in the UP.
Uh-huh.
Of course, French parents.
Uh-huh.
One grandmother didn't speak English at all. And he loved her, and he loved staying at her house as a child, because she always baked raspberry pie for him. He came to Muskegon in 1924.
Okay.
And I don't know when he married Doris. And, I started telling you about the garden. So, if I'd be out weeding in Frank's garden and Earl was weeding in his, you know, we'd wave and say, hi, neighbor. Mm-hmm. Or if he was at the top of the hill and I was in my own yard working, always, because I was a gardener.
Mm-hmm.
Hi, neighbor, how you doing? And I would run across him at parties, the Lonawets. But they had their Muskegon people, and we had the beach people, and but everybody, so that was their social life, except bit by bit they got more and more because of Earl's drumming, and Earl and who lived next.
Marilyn Andreessen played the bass.
Her parents.
Yeah, I'm trying to...
We knew them.
I know
Myrtle that. And... Well, he played piano.
I see, okay. So they kind of used to get together every once in a while and just play drums, piano, and...
Well, Earl really played drums professionally when he got into Muskegon.
Mm-hmm.
In after 1924. I don't know why that date sticks. Oh, I know, because I went up to the UP with him, or we went up together, for his 50th high school class reunion.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I, so that must
that
have...
That was the time that he moved.
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Oh, wow. Yeah, Earl played in the Jinx.
So he studied drums up in the Upper Peninsula.
Okay, so back in the 20s.
No, before that, before he, when he was growing up.
Yeah, right.
Uh-huh. and in Muskegon. He played with a band that played in, do you ever get on to what we call the BLT?
Oh, yes.
For Perch?
Right.
Oh, well. He played with a band over there and other Muskegon bands, but we didn't know too much about what was going on in Muskegon, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew the name Lanoet. And as I say, we were just, but I knew Doris. But Penny and Marva, you see, sailed together and everything. Penny knew Earl better than I did. Well, and the reason I mentioned the Galapoa was that one spring, I was here alone after Frank died. But it wasn't that spring. It wasn't, because as I say, I came alone for 7 years. Vegetables started appearing on my back porch, like a fresh tomato and two cucumbers and things like that. I called up every farmer I knew in Fruitland Township and maybe out of Montague, people I'd interviewed, trying to find out where those vegetables, to thank somebody for the lovely fresh vegetables. And when Duane Chittenden, you know Duane?
Mm-hmm, Duane Pearson?
Duane Pearson, yeah. Married the second time.
Mm-hmm.
Harriet had a lovely party in the empty lot, an outdoor afternoon tea party, sort of. For Irene and
Duane.
And I knew the editor, well, you might have too, of the Forum.
Oh, yes. Berman.
Yeah, Berman, Louis Berman.
Yeah.
And I had a message or something I wanted to tell Louis or ask him about or something. And Louis was there at this party, and I was there, of course. And Louis was talking to Earl Lanoet, but this was my chance to bust in and give Louis this message I had, or whatever I wanted to talk to him about. And Earl and I said, "Hi, neighbor," or something like that, you know. And when I was ready to leave, Earl said, "Are you enjoying your vegetables?" I said, "Earl Lanoet, of course it was you leaving him on, because Frank had started him gardening, you see."
I'll be darned.
I never thought of the man next door.
And so that was the beginning of a very long relationship?
No, not really. I see him at parties, because he, especially after he was widowed.
I see.
Mm-hmm. After Doris died, of course I wrote him a sympathy letter, naturally. And he went to Europe because his kids, Bill and Louise, and their two, lived in Europe. And when I got back here and saw him for the first time, waved to him up the hill, "Hi, neighbor. Why don't you come down sometime and tell me about your trip to Europe?" And he said, "I'll just do that." And he did. And we sat here and talked, and he told me about the trip. And then maybe 3 weeks later, he invited me down to a Muskegon Red football game, high school game,
mm-hmm.
to dinner. And So I saw him 2-3 times, maybe that year. Uh-huh. That was all. He was never going to remarry, and I certainly never was. Well, he came out to California, where his brother was. And Billy Baldwin, who had the orchestra that he had played in at BLT, and he'd played with other orchestras too in Muskegon. Mm-hmm. And Billy Baldwin and his wife were good friends of my sister and then later me in California. Mm-hmm. So Earl was visiting in California. And I saw him then. He came out the next year. And, of course, then I saw him again, because I'd seen him several times in the summer up here. And he said he was up north to visit his brother. And would I like to go along? Would I like the trip? And my family, his brother used to be a policeman in Muskegon. And my family knew him very well, the brother. Mm-hmm. But I didn't. I never met him. Because, of course, I was up here all the time. Yeah. And so I drove with him up north. And his brother's wife had called me also to invite me then, when Earl said he'd like to bring somebody. Mm-hmm. And the first thing his brother did when we got there, oh, and his brother was a darling, was to get Earl to one side and say, "Are you going with her, or are you married?" And Earl said no, and he said, "It's a good thing. I forgot to ask you when you asked, could you bring somebody up? Because we only have one guest room, and up the street is his brother was sheriff of the whole county up north of Sacramento. Yeah. And he said, up the street, I've got a room for you at a motel.
Oh.
So I got to be good friends with his brother and his wife. Uh-huh. So the next time Earl came out to California, always to see the Baldwins, supposedly, and asked me again if I'd like to fly up to fly to Sacramento, and then the sheriff would meet us in Sacramento, because they lived up, oh, probably 10 miles from, maybe more. And we had such a good time, the four of us, then again.
So it kept building. It kept going. That's neat.
And it took time, I'm telling you.
It took a while. Yeah, you were both dedicated not to do it again.
Mm-hmm.
When did Earl again start playing the Jinx? Do you have any idea when Earl started to play the drums? I know back when I started, he was playing the drums, which was in the 50s. When I started in the Jinx, he was in there in the 50s. Do you happen to remember how long before that Earl was playing the drums? Okay, this is Lana. What we were talking about, Frank Adams, you were telling me about
making booze.
About drinking booze during Prohibition, and you were telling me how he used to make his gin. Could you describe that for us again?
Well, of course, I wasn't much of a drinker. But we used to have, sitting in the living room, a bottle of scotch and a bottle of seltzer in glasses. And I started drinking scotch and warm. We never used ice. Well, the British people don't, so we didn't, I guess. Well, anyway, not with scotch, anyhow. And he introduced me to, he said, now if you're going to drink, and I drank very little. And I didn't think I liked cocktails or want cocktails, because they were pretty strong. And he said, if you're going to drink, you've got to learn to drink like an officer and a gentleman. Okay with me. So he made his own gin, as I say.
How did he do that? Would you describe the...
Well, it was something he got out of Chicago that would be sent in the parcel post. And where he got the alcohol, I don't really know. It must have been locally somewhere.
Maybe drugstore had the alcohol used to be a fountain.
Maybe he had a secret with Clarence Pitkin.
Clarence made gin too, I know.
Yeah, did he?
Yeah.
Well, it could have been, but I wouldn't have the remotest idea. And it was just something he put so much alcohol in, and I never saw him do it, to tell you the truth. But it was a big glass bottle, which would either hold a half gallon. It must have been a gallon, because it was a pretty good size glass bottle. And, of course, he only did this once. But he got all his, because I wasn't much interested. But I had learned to like martinis.
Mm-hmm.
As I say, he told me I ought to drink like an officer and a gentleman. So apparently he'd run short of gin, and he would make drinks for friends who'd come in and want to drink. But this particular time, he got the whole bottle and went up into the bedroom, which is up two steps, as the library is, on that side of the house. And sat down in my rocking chair he had a lovely sense of humor, with this gin, and sat there rocking away, maybe even singing, I don't know. And finally he said, there, I think that's aged enough, now we'll have our cocktail.
That's great. So during Prohibition, people, as you say, drank as much as they do now. It was just against the law.
Not so many people.
Not as many, huh?
Yeah.
But people drank, and were there drugs? Did you see drugs in Hollywood? Was there
no
marijuana?
I didn't know a thing about. I still don't know very much about drugs.
Okay. So that was more of a recent occurrence.
Oh yeah.
It was back then in the drugstores, you could buy things that had, like cocaine in them and things like that, so it probably wasn't as big of a deal.
Well, you could with prescriptions, I suppose. Because
mm-hmm.
a lot of doctors have been arrested for prescriptions,
yeah.
In, you know.
Yeah, well,
but now with kids and everything, it's terrible, and kids drinking so young.
Yes. You know, and that was, yeah, because, you know, even when we came to Sylvan Beach, we didn't really start drinking once or twice before we were 18, we did it. But not until we were 18, 19, 20,
yeah.
We were older.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's strange. Do you have any other memories of Prohibition? Do you have any...
Well, I remember being in New York, and as I say, I looked awfully young, which was not very good with a husband who was 20 years older anyway. And in New York, we were taken to a speakeasy, so to speak.
Knock on the door and everything?
I don't remember how we got in. Somebody had taken us. People had taken us. And I didn't even have a drink. They wouldn't serve me a drink.
And that's during Prohibition, and they were doing it against the law, and you couldn't get served a drink anyhow.
Yeah. But there
well,
wasn't...
That is an hypocrisy. I don't know yeah. what it is.
And then we did go to a few in Hollywood.
A few parties where there was...
No, not parties.
Speakeasies.
Speakeasies, yeah.
Wow, that's wild. And but so were they very top secret, or was it the type of crime that was going on? Was that just going on and everybody just turned their head? And they
well, I guess so. I don't really know.